task this morning is to get through 11 verses.
Oh, yeah, right.
Our task this morning is to get through 11 verses. I pray that we will accomplish that. Hebrews chapter 4, verses 1 through 11. And the word of the Lord says, therefore, while the promise of entering his rest still stands, let us fear lest any of you should seem to have failed to reach it. For good news came to us just as to them, but the message they heard did not benefit them, because they were not united by faith with those who listened. For we who have believed entered that rest, as he has said, as I swore in my wrath, they shall not enter my rest. Although his works were finished from the foundations of the world, for he has somewhere spoken of the seventh day in this way, and God rested on the seventh day from all his work. And again, in this passage, he said, they shall not enter my rest. Since, therefore, it remained for some to enter it, and to those who formerly received the good news failed to enter because of disobedience, again he appoints a certain day today, saying, through David so long afterward, in the words already quoted, today if you hear his voice, do not harden your hearts. For if Joshua had given them rest, God would not have spoken of another day later on. So then, there remains a Sabbath rest for the people of God. For whoever has entered God's rest has also rested from his works, as God did from his. Let us therefore strive to enter that rest, so that no one may fall by the same sort of disobedience. This is the word of the Lord. Father, we're so grateful that you have allowed us to come together this morning. And as we have reasoned from your text, Lord, we just ask that you would just continue to look over us, Lord God, and help us understand what rest means. Father, we ask that you would give us insight to what you are telling us, Lord God, and we ask that you would clear out the muck out of our minds so that we can hear completely from you. Father, we are grateful, we are thankful, and we are welcoming your spirit to be amongst us. Help me as a teacher teach your word. It is in Jesus' mighty name we all say amen.
Amen.
This morning, as we continue our lesson in the book of Hebrews, one of the things that we realize we have come to in chapter 4 is rest. I don't know about you, but every now and then I get a little tired. Sometimes I'm a little tired from doing things that I should do, and sometimes I'm a little tired from things that I'm doing that I should not do. But we are all encompassed and surrounded by sin. And I'm grateful this morning in regards, especially to this text, in regards to the doctrine of perseverance. I don't know if you know this doctrine or not, but it's called the doctrine of the perseverance of the saints. Once saved, you're always saved. Do you understand that? I think we all should say amen. I think the Bible speaks of this over 12 times. Once a person is saved, they will always be saved. And this is where we struggle sometimes, because some of the saved folks we think that are saved ain't really saved. Have you noticed somebody's life like that?
Amen.
Just because somebody say that they're a Christian doesn't mean that they are a Christian.
Amen.
They can speak Christianese, but they may not walk Christian-like.
Come on, Pastor. Come
and there's a couple of things that we need to really realize, especially when we want to experience this ultimate rest that Jesus gives us. Remember, in this whole theme of this book, we talk about Jesus is better than anything
and
everything. And the church said amen.
Amen.
There you go, you Pentecostal folks. That's what I'm talking about. I made priest this morning. But we get to a place in our lives where we must realize that Jesus is the creator of all things. He's in all things. And because he's in all things, and especially if we are his, he preserves what is his, right?
Amen.
Now, if we can put Oreo cookies on the shelf for about 5 years, right? And we pack them with preservatives. What happens when the Holy Spirit himself envelops us to keep us and to guide us and to walk with us to preserve us till the end? And this is where we must understand, especially when we talk about entering God's rest. We only enter God's rest because we are preserved by him if we are truly born again. Now, you may have times in your life when you have fits. Now, how many of y'all have fits in your life? And the fit can be whatever fit you want. Not an outfit, but an in-fit. You know what I'm talking about? The in-fit of your heart. And every now and then, we get to a place and we question our salvation. But the Bible teaches that in regards to who we are and what we are, if the Holy Spirit is with us and if we are convicted by what we are doing, we know that God is working in us and working on us.
Hallelujah.
Right?
Yes, Lord.
See, when you lived a while, you started to realize that God really loves you. Because if you think about yourself, you would have gave up on yourself a long, long time ago, right? Look, I'm tired of you already. How many of y'all get tired of yourself? I'm tired of myself already. And sometimes we don't persevere with our own self. I'm ready to quit you. Right? Speaking to ourselves in the third person. But it's in this text, it's a complicated passage. It's a complicated passage to better understand our grasp of the broad lines that we look at the details of what rest truly means. When we say we want to rest, what do we mean? Come on, talk to me, somebody. When you want to rest, what do you want to do?
Relax.
You want to take a nap. All right, what else?
Relax.
What else?
Nothing.
Okay, nothing. And what else? What else? Come on, talk to me, somebody. What else?
Sleep.
All right, nap and sleep are the same thing, but I got you. I understand, brother. What else? Come on, talk to me. When you want to rest, what do you want to do?
Stop working.
Vacation.
Shut my mind.
Oh, shut your mind off. I wish I could do that, but sometimes it don't work.
I know it don't.
I toss and turn at night because my mind is still going.
Yes.
But in this complicated passage, we see this. We see that this word rest has different stages or different senses of meaning here. At first, this word rest could be that God would use his peace to set upon us. And it would be nothing better in the world to have the peace of God sitting on your life, right? Or we could see in chapter 3, verse 1 and 2, or verse 12, it says that this rest could mean a promise. You know, like if you get to a place, like if you travel on the world road and all you want to do is just get to the what? Rest stop.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
That means you stop and you rest.
Yeah.
And we see in this text that it could be used in the rest of God the Father, rested after the sixth day of creation. Mm-hmm. And see, the big idea this morning is this here, family. Jesus provides spiritual rest, but believers must claim God's promised rest. Mm-hmm. And see, our rest and God's rest is totally different.
Amen.
I'm going to blow your mind this morning because, see, sometimes you think you want to rest, you want to sleep, you want to go tired, you want to be tired, you want to stop. But, see, God's rest is totally different. And if we embrace God's rest, then what happens is that we will be restful. And I think this is where the text is going to teach us this morning of how to have this ultimate rest. In verse 1 and 2, The writer of the text says, therefore, while the promise of entering his rest still stands, let us fear lest any of you should seem to have failed to reach it. For good news came to us just as to them. But the message they heard did not benefit them because they were not united by faith with those who listened. Now, in this context, one of the things I want you to get right out and open in front of you, rest refers to an experience of salvation we enter by faith in Jesus Christ. See, those who have begun their Christian walk by an experience of faith in Jesus Christ, demonstrated by our own reality that we are committed, and our commitment to Christ comes from the enjoyment of the rest that God has promised us.
All right.
And those who have stopped or ceased to share in that rest show this by their spiritual failure and their lack of profession of the faith was false. See, what I'm trying to tell you here, y'all, and this is what I want to share with you. The writer of this book is getting to just the meat of what's going on at this particular time with the people at this point in time in history. They are a group of people who are struggling. They are struggling with their faith. They are struggling with their relationship. They are struggling with their finances. They are struggling with their living conditions. They are being persecuted by the church or by those who seem like they are the church. They are being persecuted by those who don't like Christians. But we need to get to a place where we understand the contextual background of what's truly going on. So it's just kind of like this. When we look at the broad picture in the Old Testament, we see that the children of Israel are under bondage, right? They are slaves. So the slaves have rest, right? But we also see that God himself, in order to give them rest, he brought them out of the bondage of Egypt to give them rest, but at the same time, they still had the slave mentality because they were in the presence of God, but at the same time, they did not rest. How many of us are like that? God don't brought you out, and you still a slave to it, and you wonder why you ain't resting. You track with me? And we see that this uniting of the faith, they need to be united, but they fail to reach it. We see the rest appears in Hebrews chapter 3, verses 11 through 4, 1, in several different emphases. And what we see, the Bible also says that it appears in a term that refers to the experience of salvation. See, when you saved, you know you saved. It's not saying that life is going to be a bed of roses. It's not saying that you're going to float around on a cloud. Sometimes life may be difficult. All the time life is difficult. I struggle with the prosperity theology that says all you got to do is speak it, tweak it, work it, twerk it, and everything will come to you. I have done all of that. Ain't nothing happened yet. Maybe it don't work for me.
Come on,
Doc, right? I done worked it, I done twerked it, I done spoke it, I done did all that. And it just, maybe I'm just not doing it right. Maybe I'm trying to figure out why my life ain't easy. Come on now, who I'm talking to in here, right? I'm trying to figure out, is it just me? Or am I doing something wrong?
No.
That's all right. That's all right.
See, salvation comes with this experience with Christ.
Jesus.
And this is what the writer is saying at this point in time. He says, let us fear lest any of you should seem to have failed to reach it. In other words, this word fear has a word of disobedience may be attached to it. It's not a fear that you're going to die, but it's a fear that you reverence the thing that you are trying to understand. In other words, what he's saying, let us be careful how the NIV translated. He wanted his readers to live not in disobedience, but in obedience to God. He wanted them to be awakened in repentance. And when it comes to fearing something, the Greek word for fear is what we get our word phobia from. You know, like when we're scared of different, like arachnophobia. You know what arachnophobia means, right? Yeah. What does that mean? Talk to me.
Spiders.
So if you see a spider, you're going to tuck tail in high water and get out of there, right?
Quickly.
In other words, this word fear has a meaning that you are so afraid of it that you would flee from it. Yes. And see, this particular fear that the writer wants us to understand is a fear of not entering God's rest. Mm. Have you been there? Mm-hmm. Yeah, have you been there for a while where it just seems like you just don't feel like you're entering God's rest? Mm-hmm. And see, what I want to tell you today, it's very possible. It is very possible that this does enter a Christian life. Mm-hmm. And we are to be in a place where we are to enter God's rest. When we think about the children of Israel, and the writer refers to a lot of it in the text itself, God had promised that they could enter the land of Canaan, right? Mm-hmm. He says, okay, this is your promised land. In other words, this is your rest. Mm-hmm. But out of all the folks that he sent to scout out Canaan, how many came back with a good answer?
Two.
Two, right?
Two.
Those two came back with a good answer. And what we see here at this point in time, if we just kind of contextualize it to our own lives, it is easy to see the negative things, right? It is hard to see God's promises. But see, all God needs is two.
That's it.
All I need is two in this church, including myself. I just need to pair my faith up next to somebody else's faith, and all I need is two people to see what God is going to do and promise.
Come on.
Right?
That's it.
And because of disobedience, the majority of people didn't make it into God's rest.
Yes.
It makes you wonder sometimes, right? It gives you this picture of wide as the gate, broad as the road that leads to destruction, and many go in by it. And then there's this narrow is the gate, and difficult is the way that leads to everlasting life. And there is few that find it. Preach, Pastor, preach.
Come on.
And see, this is where we must realize, especially, we need to be aware of the previous failures so that we won't make the same mistake.
Mm-hmm.
See, last week we talked about testimonies, and we heard some really good testimonies last week. And one of the things that I took of it, that I listened to everyone who shared their testimony, whatever they went through, I don't want to go through. They gave me a cheat code, because when I get to that particular area in my life, what I'm going to do, I'm going to avoid it.
Amen.
And what we need to realize, especially as believers in Christ, we need to truly understand that the claim to rest in God is intended for God's people. We see in the text when he talks about the good news came to us just as to them. In other words, they heard the same message that we're hearing. Only thing is that we're getting the fulfillment. We have the fulfillment of the message, but they heard the same message. Have you been around people who've heard the same thing you heard, but they hear different things? Don't those people frustrate you? I'm saying one thing, but you're hearing something else. Have you talked to somebody like that?
Yes.
Just look at your neighbor and say, just look at your neighbor and say, listen, neighbor, listen. Go ahead, look at your neighbor and say, listen. Go ahead. Just say, listen. I'm saying one, you hearing something else. And we see that it was a failure, it was a mistake. And the good news, the message had come to them, but they heard something totally different. They were refugees from Israel, or from Egypt. And they had a message of deliverance. They were already delivered.
Amen.
Who I'm talking to in here right now? God had already called you out, and you're already delivered, but you're going back into it again. Or are you dwelling on the past? And you're dwelling on the past in relationships. You're dwelling on the past experiences. You're dwelling on the past things that you went through. And you're trying to take your past and put it in your future.
Yeah, all right.
Come on now. That's why it's your past, so that you can make better decisions. Because if your past was that good, you would still be in it.
Well,
come on now. Come on, talk to me. If your relationships was that good in the past, you were still being there, right?
Yes, that part.
Quit bringing up your past. God's trying to bring you out of Egypt into freedom, into a new promised land. But you keep holding on. Well, I used to be treated like this. I used to be hugged like this. I used to be loved like this.
Preach, Pastor.
I used to be talked to like this. See, God is trying to tell you something, but you keep going back to Egypt, and he's trying to get you to the promised land of ultimate rest. He said, you want the promise, baby, I'm giving you the promise, but you keep going back. Remember the children of Israel, what did they want? Yeah. They get a little bit now. There was their fault. They were right there. They could have chose God's ultimate rest. They were already God's saved group from a national perspective. They could have went in and conquered the land of Canaan. They could have experienced in one aspect God's rest. But because they went through a little tough time, because they chose to, they said, God, you can't do this. Now imagine this. God himself on one side of a cloud that divided the Israelites from the Egyptians. On one side of the cloud, he was day to them. On the other side of the cloud, he was night and darkness to the Egyptians. So he kept them at bay. They see the miracles of the Ten Commandments, or the Ten Plagues that took place, and God brought them out, but at the same time, they still didn't believe the promise that was in front of us. How many of us in here don't have rest because we don't believe God's promise?
Jesus.
Preach, Pastor, preach.
Come on, preach.
Good word, yes.
Jesus, at this point in time, and I believe he's sharing with us, we got to hear the gospel and believe it, man. The gospel is salvation. The gospel is rest.
Hallelujah.
And you see, sometimes in order for us to receive this rest, we need to make our faith response. And when we make a faith response, we receive value, we receive the promise, we receive blessings, we declare the gospel message itself. See, this is a practical truth. I want you to make sure you get this. We get no benefit from merely hearing the gospel. We must believe it and act on it to receive its benefits. It ain't enough just to hear, I love you. Come on now, you got to act on it, right? I need y'all to listen to me. I need y'all to look up. I need you to listen to me. Come on, listen to me. I don't want this to go over your head. We need to hear the gospel, and we need to act on the gospel, all right? Because this is where we get into a place where we're trying to figure out life, and life is hitting us with a ton of bricks, and we just in la la land. Has life hit you with a ton of bricks? Are you going through certain things in your own life right now? Come on, talk to me right now. And you wonder why you're going through certain things, because you're not holding on to the promise, you're not holding on, and you're not claiming the rest. Hebrews 11:6 says it this way, and without faith. Oh, come on now. Come on, theologians. You already got that.
Yes.
And without faith, it is
impossible
to please him. For whoever would draw near to God must believe that he exists and that he rewards those who seek him. Do we believe God exists?
Amen.
Do our actions line up all the time that we believe God exists?
Not all the time.
Come on now. We won't talk to you here. Come on. See, when we know God exists, that's when we walk through life with a sense of rest. We're still moving, we're still acting in faith, and we're still doing the things that we need to do and that we believe that we can do. But what happens is that because we know God exists, we are literally, and we're acting in faith, saying that, okay, God, I know you exist. I ain't got to add nothing to it, but I'm just going to be obedient in what you want me to do. See, sometimes we don't have that rest because we are disobedient. See, when we're obedient, we know that God exists. And God says, okay, to show you that I know, that you know that I'm real. What did the text say? He rewards those who seek him. Verses 3 through 6, the writer continue on and he says, For we who have believed entered that rest. As he said, as I swore in my wrath, they shall not enter my rest. Although his works were finished from the foundation of the world, for he has somewhere spoken of the seventh day in this way, and God rested on the seventh day from all his works. And again in the passage he said, they shall not enter my rest. Since therefore it remained for some to enter it. You know that, right? Since therefore. Now he's giving a reason why. And those who formerly received the good news failed. Come on, Doc. What you say? Because of what?
Disobedience.
The psalmist quote, or the writer quotes Psalms 95, 7 through 11. And what we see here, those who put their faith in Jesus Christ enjoy that rest. See, sometimes life is a little hard for me, but I'm okay. Come on now, who am I talking to? Sometimes life is just a little hard for me. But when life is hard, I can rest. I can be, okay, God, you with it, and you in it. One way or another, I'm going to get through it. Either I'm going to see you on this day, or you're going to keep on helping me persevere until the day that you call me home. There are times in your life, come on, let me talk to you. There are times in your life when you're just ready to give up, right? Now, I would say give up the ghost. You deal with certain people, God, take me home right now. I ain't even got to tell them bye. Come on, have you been there? Have you lived long enough? Like, Lord, you know what? These folks right here just shaking my nerves. I don't know how you shake somebody's nerves, but it sounds good. You know what I'm saying? It's like in this place, we get to a place where we want this ultimate rest. And what happens is we can't enter the rest. Why? Because we don't actually enjoy what Jesus has done for us.
Oh, Jesus.
What has Jesus done for you? Well, what's that song? Who sang that? Was it Janet Jackson? What have you done for me lately? Oh, don't do that? Okay. I was trying to get the shoulders in there. Add a little extra flavor to it. You know, just trying to get a little shoulder movement in there to get the action, to get your effect. But do we ask that of God? What have you done for me lately? And he says, okay, you ready? And then when you figure it out, like, oh yeah, you did do all of that. See, those who believed entered that rest. And this rest initially is at the moment of conversion. But then also we get a better experience, a more full experience for the rest in the future. Those who truly experience God's rest share in the experience of salvation. Now, this tense of this word believe, or the participle, it indicates that the writer's not only speaking of one moment when faith comes in Jesus Christ, but it talks about this belief that is this persistent Christian life change that one needs for the full reward of God. So in other words, when life gets difficult, I still need you to believe. Thus says the Lord. Not, and I ain't a prophet. I'm just saying this is what the word says, all right? He said, thus says the Lord. No. God says, when life gets difficult, I still need you to believe.
Yes, yes, yes.
I still need you to believe in your marriage.
Yes.
I still need you to believe in your health.
Yes.
I still need you to believe in your finances.
Yes.
I still need you to believe in your work. I still need you to believe in your relationships. I still need you to believe in the promises that I promised for you. I still need you to believe that your child one day going to be saved. I still need you to believe. Come on now.
Yes, God. Yes, Lord. Jesus.
I still need you to believe.
I believe it.
When God was dealing with Israel, he had already saved them from Egypt. But at the same time, they did not continue to trust him and believe on him. And he swore that he would not let them enter the land. Man, I hope that's none of us. Come on now, we're going to talk. I hope that's none of us. I mean, God has brought you out, but you still believing in the negative. Then he goes on, and in one aspect, he says, furthermore, the rest resembles God's rest, or the Sabbath. Verse 3 refers to God's rest since creation. Now, when we think God rested from creation, what do we think God did? You think he just put his feet up and said, enough is done? God rested, right? Because, you know, we can take words and we go, yeah, God rested, so I need to rest. God rested from the creation aspect of it. But he's still God. He's still working. If he just rested in creationism and just threw it into the world, just let it kind of, you know, take on its own role, take on its own, there would be no work. There would be nothing else to do, right? And this is what I want us to realize, because I asked you a specific question earlier. I asked you a question in regards to rest, and you said, hey, rest for me is sleeping. Rest for me is not doing anything. Rest for me is taking a nap. Rest for me is having a vacation. Rest for me is shutting off my mind.
Wow.
Rest for me is what else? Come on, talk to me. What else? What else rests for you? What else not rest is for you?
No work.
No work. All right. But what I want you to realize here, this rest, what it speaks of in the text, cannot be defined as inactivity. See, that's our thinking. You know what I'm saying? That's our thinking. Sometimes we think that we rest, we're not doing it. But see, when God's resting, it doesn't mean that he's not doing anything. It rather involves a sense of completion. In other words, the rest Christians can enjoy today comes when we willingly take on Jesus' yoke. There's always going to be a place and time. There's always going to be a time in life where you're going to have a yoke on. It may not be as heavy, but there's always going to be a yoke. This is why he said this in Matthew chapter 11, verses 28 through 30. He says this, "Come to me, all who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you
rest.
Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you will find rest
for your soul."
For your soul.
Come on.
I need y'all to say this with me because I know some of y'all need rest in you. Let's say verse 30 together. "For my yoke is easy and my burden is light." And the church said amen. Y'all about to make me go Pentecostal here, even though I'm not. See, what we must understand, family, is this: a consistent, continual faith that applies the word of God is necessary for entrance into the full and final rest. I know we all get tired sometimes. I know we all get strained a little bit. But there's a rest that's needed that only Jesus can provide. See, sometimes the busyness of life distracts you and makes you tired. And we find rest coupled by obedience in Christ to find fulfillment. You ever wonder why some people run to the church and they serve in the church? And they serve in the church and it's edifying to their soul. And what happens is that they just love being around the church because it's not work, even though they're working. Because when we think about biblical rest and we talk about God's rest, it's not an activity. Think about this. When you are around Jesus in the throne room, when we are all in heaven, what do you think we're going to be doing? Floating on clouds, eating bonbons with a piece of potato pie?
Holy, holy, holy.
What are we going to be doing, Sister Rebecca?
Singing, holy, holy, holy.
And that's going to be rest.
Lord God, thy almighty.
See, some of y'all don't get it. When we worship in the morning, I get so encouraged by the voices. When we worship in the morning, my soul goes into rest. When you are in grieving pain, when you are frustrated, when you are agitated, the act of worship. Now, you are doing something, right? But what happens is that you are resting your spirit. And when your spirit is resting, your mind is rested also. See, we need to get a group of people who know how to rest while they work.
Hello.
All right, Lord.
I played football a long, long time ago. I know I don't look like it.
That's all right, Pastor.
That's all right. Pray for me. Pray for me.
That's all right.
My coach used to always say one thing, Stansberry, rest while you work. I didn't get that. I didn't understand. I'm like, well, babe, you tell me to rest. I need to get down and get some water. No, he's saying rest while you work, because if you rest while you work, you're doing your job.
Yeah.
This is where the gospel makes sense for those who are in Jesus. The gospel makes sense, especially when it comes to this continual, consistent faith. And it gives us the ability to go into this rest that God has given us. Now, the point of this is that God rested after he had completed his work and plan. And this is what God is demanding here for all believers. Finish your course of faith faithfully.
Thank you, Jesus.
And you shall enter my rest. In verses 4 and 5, we see two different quotes. We see a quote from Genesis chapter 2, where God himself was showing that he was resting. And what we see here, that it didn't last. We see that God never returned to the work of creation. We may understand this as continuous, but what we must understand, especially here, believers can share in that type of rest in a sense of completion today. Anyone who responds to God's message with faith and obedience assumes Christ's yokes and entered that rest in the relationship with God. And see, this idea of rest does not mean we sit around sipping spiritual lemonade or whatever we drink. And what it means is that we have this idea of total acceptance of God and God's blessing and his presence. In other words, we enter rest with Jesus when we find God's presence and blessing. God's salvation produces people who receive divine energy to serve, to obey, and to work for him. That's resting in God. Now, see, because we are sinful, we live in this heavenly realm. Okay, this is one of the heavenly realms, full of sin, but a heavenly realm. And the only reason why we get tired, why do you think we get tired? Is the effect of sin on the body. And see, when sin affects the body, what happens is that you get tired. We don't operate fully as we are because we are spiritual beings. But in order to operate in this side, all right, on this side of eternity, we have to have bodies, physical bodies to operate. That's why demons can't do nothing without a host. So when you see demonic forces going on and you see influences and all this other good stuff, how we study in Ephesians, and they talk about, you know, spiritual principles. We see all these spiritual warfares and things like this, these highly principles and these governments and things like that. They need a body in order to operate and conduct business on this side. And we get tired because we are physical. But there's going to come a time when we have a new heavenly body and I ain't going to get tired. I'm never get tired. I ain't going to ever get tired. And that's because God himself has given us the fullness of his rest. In verse 5, we see this quote comes from Psalms 95:11. And what we must realize is that the psalmist offered this rest, and he shows the idea of this rest, and it's not exhausted at the Israelites. But what we see, God still has a purpose in bringing believers into that rest. But sometimes they can forfeit it. And how do we forfeit God's rest? Oh, come on now. There you go, Sister Theologian. Disobedient.
Disbelief and disobedience.
You know? That's what it does, right? I mean, that's what it is. When we're disobedient, we're not resting. You know, when you do somebody dirty and do somebody wrong, you can't sleep at night. Yeah. If you say,
amen.
Come on now.
Amen.
You say you're loose, your lips are a little bit too loose. And now you feel bad. You're like, I can't tell them what I said. Right? Come on now, have you been there?
Amen.
When you ain't saved, you have, forget that. I'm going to sleep. Right? It's like the Holy Spirit just sets on you and convicts you. You know what you did was wrong. But they don't know what I did. Well, okay, well, I need you to confess to me. You ain't got to go to them, because you go to them, it's going to be trouble. But I need you to confess to me. Come on now. See, I'm trying to help some of y'all new Christians. I'm trying to help some of y'all old Christians. You know, I talked about you like a dog. But I wanted to ask you to forgive me. Whoa, I didn't know you were talking about me. Right? Have you been there?
Jesus.
These words became an appeal to those who did not obey. And see, we have this hope of experience rest if we follow in obedience that shows our faith in God's message, the gospel. Verse 6 talks about it is possible to enter the full rest and final rest. Rest in place, but not enter it. And the key factor, as we said before, was disobedience. God wants his people to live a consistent life of fear so that they would not counterfeit their eternal honor. Mm. Now, it's possible to be saved, but you know how you literally say saved by grace? Mm-hmm. You can be saved and not have any rewards in heaven. I don't know of anybody that want to be saved like that. That's just like God saving everybody and giving everybody a Cadillac. I don't know why I said Cadillac. But giving everybody a come on, what?
Come on.
You know, it's like God saving everybody, and then all of a sudden you saved, but you ain't driving no Cadillac. Mm. Right?
Come on.
See, the Bible talks about some of us are going to get in there. I ain't including myself, but some of us going to get in there by the fire of our road. We ain't going to have nothing, but we're going to be like, whoa, I got in. That's going to be good in itself, right? But that ain't good enough. I want to make sure, as your pastor, I want to make sure that's good, but that ain't good enough. Because if you looking at the white throne when it's time to give your judgment,
come on.
I can't help you.
Come on.
I hope I ain't in line with you.
Come on.
Pastor, you talking about, no, brother, you in that line. I'm in that line. No. I can only go with yourself.
Come on.
I'm going to be like Nazareth. There's a void. Even though I want to come and get you, I can't.
You're a real player, huh?
Oh, Jesus.
See, the determining factor is that do we finish as winners when we obey Scripture? When the Holy Spirit convicts us, do we respond to that conviction when it's needed?
Jesus.
But if we fail to respond and persist in disobedience, we forfeit our inheritance. Not saying you ain't family, but you ain't got all the goodies that come with it.
Jesus.
Verse 7, he says again, he appoints a certain day today, saying through David so long after in the words already quoted, today if you hear his voice, do not harden your hearts.
Come on.
Do you know God has a certain day that he's going to shut everything down?
Yes.
And this urgency of today is like right now.
Yes.
It's like, okay, I need you to get it right now. Because tomorrow ain't promised. I need you right now to get it.
Right now.
So today is your opportunity for God to get in God and remain in God's rest.
Come on.
At one point in time, each of us will have to deal with that day. And either we'll be raptured out or either we'll be called. But what happens is that the Bible tells us, do not harden your heart. Mm-hmm. In other words, it means to stubbornly harden your heart, or it means the opposite of being tenderhearted to conviction of the Holy Spirit. In other words, it's an outcome of uncertainty. The potential to harden a heart as a believer is very real and very possible for any believer if they don't hear God's word. And if they're not convicted by his truth, God can convict you on a certain day. And on that day, when he convicts you, you need to respond. Verses 8 through 11, he says, for if Joshua had given them rest, God would not have spoken of another day later on. So then, there remains a Sabbath rest for the people of God. For whoever has entered God's rest has also rested from, get this, his works as God did from his. Let us therefore strive to enter that rest so that no one may fall by the same sort of disobedience. In other words, there is a final rest which features full benefits and rewards of God that is possible if we don't miss it through disobedience. According to verse 8, we see Joshua himself had led the children of Israel into the promised land, right? We talked about that earlier, right?
Right.
Now, out of all those people, only two got to see it. And they got to enter into the fullness of God's rest. Mm-hmm. Now, what we also realize is that God himself didn't say that rest would be free from hostility. Mm. See, that's what we get in our minds sometimes, right? We think that if we're resting in God, ain't nothing going to go wrong. Go turn on your car right now. If it turns on, good. If it don't turn on, you need to rest. Right? See, we got this false theology that everything's gonna always be good. See, sometimes God wants you resting in pain. I don't understand that.
I don't either.
I don't understand it, but sometimes God himself say, okay, your rest is going to be pain. Because if I don't give you pain, you ain't going to rest. And our rest in pain is obedience and submission to him. How many people on the deathbed call out the name of Jesus? If they know him. If their heart's not hardened toward him, right? Everybody's going to know Jesus. See, we got to get to a place in our own lives where we see, okay, God, you have led us into the promised land, and many thought that they had been in the promised land, but they really wasn't because they really were not converted. This is why I tell you, everybody who said they're Christian ain't no Christian. It's like ladies. Like, good, I'm glad you believe in the Lord, Savior, Jesus Christ. You got people who can quote scripture like scripture hadn't been quoted before. You got people who have memory verses of scripture, but there has been no rejuvenation. There has been no conviction. There has been no work. There has been nothing. And see, this bogs my mind because in Matthew chapter 7, what Jesus is going to say? Didn't we, to those who thought that they believed? Come on, didn't we cast out demons? Didn't we raise the dead? Didn't we heal the sick? Didn't I come to church every Sunday morning? Didn't I give? And on that day, depart from me, you workers of iniquity. And he says, I never knew you. Don't that make you check yourself? You want to say, Lord, is that real? Okay, I'm saved. You know, God, make sure I'm saved. I'm saved. I know I got many issues. I got my issues. I messed up a lot in my life. Messed up so much I can't tell you everything. You know, you tell everybody everything, they look at you a little different, you know? You can't tell everybody everything. Come on now, preach. Who do you want to tell? You can't tell everybody everything, because if you tell everybody everything, then everything will be out. Then everybody's like, ooh, I can't mess with that one right now. I love you in Jesus, you know. There's that unauthentic love, you know what I'm saying?
Stay away.
Only Jesus can love you from your past, you know?
Yes, Lord. You better go ahead and preach.
Because you know how we get, we get to a place where we put on the front. You know, we shower on Sundays. You know, we put on a little cologne, perfume.
Come on.
You know, we comb our hair. You know, some of us use Beijing Black Brown 5/8. Keep that youth, you know, just keep it real. Just keep it real, you know. When I hit that 5-0, then I'll transition, Pat. I'll transition. But right now, I'm holding on to it with every finger. And I said finger.
That's and all right.
We get to that place where we think we're looking good, we're smelling good, and we're doing good, and all this other good stuff. But then all of a sudden, the Holy Spirit says, no, not that. And we get convicted. We look at our spouse and like, got to be kidding me. And the Holy Spirit said, why are you looking at him like that? Right? See, we only get into this rest by obedience.
Yes, Lord.
Verse 10 says, when Israel would reach the kingdom, they would rest from all the work. But what we realize, just as God rested in his creation, in other words, what we see that Israel would be in full and final resting place that God intended. But we're not in that full and final place of God, the resting place that God intended. This is why some people say rest in peace or rest in heaven, and not everybody who say rest in peace or rest in heaven are resting in peace and resting in heaven, right?
Jesus.
Faith demands a dependence on God's work instead of our own works. We can't work our way into heaven. This is what boggles my mind. When people think that they can work their way into heaven, it is impossible.
Impossible.
Not on your best day can you work your way into heaven because you are flawed. Verse 11 applies to us. Any believer who believes on Jesus Christ ceases from depending on his own works and trust in the finished work of Jesus Christ. And see, it's not possible to fall from that position of rest. There's nothing that I can do to earn my salvation. But what we must realize, how the Bible says we are not saved by works, we are saved unto good works. So in other words, as a Christian, we are saved unto good works. So when you are saved, you desire to do God's stuff. You yes. desire, if yes. you're saved and all you want to do is stay home and sleep, let me just be real. Something's wrong. Something's not adding up right. When you say that you have no desire to be with the fellowship of the brethren, something's wrong. And when you are saved and you rather hang around heathens than people inside the church, I'm talking about real people in church. Not every church is a church. Let me be real with y'all, because ain't every church a church. Some church is like, oh, that ain't right. You going there, they looking at you sideways. You know, like you see some of those old mothers in the church look like they've been sucking on lemons for the last 20 years. They don't greet you with a smile. They greet you with a growl. How you doing? You know, like they've been talking like they've been smoking on a pack of Newports for the past 20 years. Let me stop. I'm sorry, Lord.
Preach.
Right.
We get to that place, man. We gotta be authentic with this.
Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord.
There should be something. If something, and this is why I tell people all the time, if this is it, this is it. There should be something, some connection, some vital sign. That's something like, I just got to see my brother there. If I can just look at him, I'm good.
Hello.
Come on now. See, some of us have been there walking our life. If I can just see him with my eye, I ain't got to touch him. I ain't got to do nothing. If I can just look at him. If I can just look at Pat on Sunday mornings.
Wow.
All right. That'll make you great.
I can just look at my vanilla bean brother just in the morning. 8:30. I'm okay.
Yes, Lord.
There is a connectedness that takes place here. This is rest. People try to figure out, man, you keep going, you keep preaching. Look, this is rest for me. You know why? Because God has empowered me. When God stops, I'm done.
Right.
This is why we can't afford to look at what we see. Because you know people will disappoint you, right?
Yeah.
Has somebody disappointed you? Yeah. Just to tell your neighbor, somebody disappointed me. Don't say you. Just say somebody disappointed me. Just go ahead and look at your neighbor and say somebody disappointed me. Go ahead. You did? You got it out? You got it out. Good. Now, I don't want y'all to be all personal. Yeah, I ain't disappointed. No. Just say somebody. We talk about you, we just say somebody, right? But the only person who don't disappoint
is God.
Is God.
Hallelujah.
I can get disappointed with you for a moment. But it won't hold long.
Yeah.
I'm human. I ain't God.
Yeah.
I make cuss. I ain't no, I don't cuss. Ooh, I like Pastor. You be cussing and everything. Just keep it real all the time. Let's go to that church. That pastor, he cuss. No. Why are your eyes bugged? You make me want to do it, but I don't do it. An old man in me, but I just keep him suppressed. Sometimes. Every now and then he'll slip out. He'll slip out. Catch me. When I say catch me on the wrong day at the right time.
It's all right, Pastor.
Enter his rest. Enter his rest. The word fall means to fall down from a lofty position. This is what he's saying in this text. There's a point in time if we are persistently hardened in our heart that we can lose our lofty position and our status. We can lose our rewards. Now remember, I told you earlier about the doctrine of perseverance of the saints. Once saved, always saved. Mm-hmm. The problem we have is we don't know who's saved.
That's it.
You know what I'm saying? And when we think somebody's saved, they may really not be saved.
Yeah.
I wish I could go in the doctrine of election, know who's really, really who. You can't. Right?
Right.
You think about this. There's a bunch of people who have been a part of the church at one point in time that said, oh, I love the church and I love this and love that, but then they're not here anymore. Not saying that they're not in the body of Christ, but they were just not meant to be here, right?
Amen.
And there's some people that may be transitioning out. It happens.
Yes.
Now, I don't know if they're saved or not. I can only go off the evidence of the fruit.
Amen.
But at the end of the day, God is going to know who's saved and who's not saved.
Thank you, Jesus.
Now that I hope, if they are a professing believer, they will be.
Amen.
And we're going to high five in heaven. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Let's pray. Father, we're so grateful that you've allowed us to come together this morning. We are thankful that you have given us this text, Lord God, in regards to this ultimate rest. We know that resting comes in you. Resting comes with you. And resting comes by you. And Father, we just ask that you would just continue to allow us to experience this spiritual rest. This rest that can be proclaimed and claimed by believers. This rest that can be tasted, Lord God. Even as we are working, Lord God, we could rest in you and all that you do and all that you say and all that you are. Keep us, lead us, guide us, and direct us. It is in Jesus' mighty name we all say amen.
Amen. Amen.